mysterious ways that goes where you find it, in the fading glow of a summer sunset, or the splash of autumn leaves by nature's paintbrush. Down, patiently panning the precious flakes from the gravel beneath their rushing waters. But more precious than the prospector's hard-won riches is the hoard of living gold taken from the vault of a female landlocked salmon. Inside her belly, more than 2,000 golden eggs have been nourished and growing, ripening toward the day when she will spawn them. Why are these eggs more precious than gold? In the whole wide world, you will find only a handful of lakes and streams nestled close together on our own continent, which can boast of landlocked salmon fishing today. And right at the heart of this area lies New Hampshire, excelled by none as a place to fish for this prize quarry at prices you can well afford. To thrive, the landlocked salmon needs large lakes with deep, cool water that is clear and plentifully supplied with oxygen, or large streams which plunge swift and clean from cool mountain sources. These waters abound in New Hampshire with such lakes as Winnipesaukee, Squam, Merrymeeting, the Connecticut, just to name a few. Sport fishing plays a very important part in the economy of the state of New Hampshire. Not only does it provide a means of recreation, fun, and food for its own residents, but folks from all over the country plan their vacation around a fishing trip to this beautiful scenic area of New England. Believe it or not, a successful fishing trip to New Hampshire has lured many a sportsman to return and buy a lot and build a camp on one of our lakes or ponds or rivers. When folks come to New Hampshire to fish, everyone benefits. The merchants, the camp owners, the boat yards, the bait dealers, and many others. It has been estimated that sport fishing alone brings over $20 million each year into New Hampshire tills. Can you see now why these eggs are more precious than gold? It is an absolute must to provide a supply of landlocked salmon and trout to meet the demand. And up to now, it has proved impossible for nature alone to keep up with the increasing pressures. Each year on opening day, every available parking spot near an area of open water is crowded with trailers and boats of every description. More and more fishermen show up with all sorts of equipment, and if they don't have what it takes, they will buy it. What follows is the story of just one phase of the New Hampshire Fish and Game Department's effort to make their state a fisherman's paradise. They work with other members of the trout family just as hard. Without man-made obstacles, nature could probably supply enough fertile eggs that would hatch into baby salmon and grow to maturity to keep the species going. There is a reason why over 2,000 eggs are developing in the belly of an average female salmon. It has been estimated that only a few hundred of these eggs will hatch after they are spawned, and even a much smaller percentage of these will ever reach maturity. Even this would be fine if all the female salmon could find a place to spawn, but in New Hampshire lakes, the fatal flaw is lack of enough suitable streams that will hold up. When landlocks are forced to lay their eggs out on some sandbar in the lake, these are practically wasted. And when they do find a stream in which to make their beds, the eggs are lost if the water level drops to leave them high and dry, or floodwaters cover them with silt and gravel to smother them. This is why New Hampshire fish culturists have developed a highly scientific program for collecting the eggs, fertilizing them, hatching them, and raising them to the point where they can survive by themselves. The Fish and Game Department has three sources from which to harvest the parent fish. Although in a good year, enough fish could be collected by any one of the three methods chosen, all of these are used to ensure a sufficient supply of eggs. The central station where all the fish are impounded is on the Melvin River, a tributary of Lake Winnipesaukee. This river has been dammed and traps and holding pens constructed. Many of the salmon swimming upriver to spawn trap themselves, and each day are netted from the pools and placed in the pens until they are ripe for stripping. This holding pen is large enough to let the salmon swim about freely and is fed by a constant stream of cool, clean water with a current strong enough to satisfy the urge of the fish to swim upstream to spawn. This gushing flow of water is also loaded with all the oxygen it can carry to supply the needs of such a concentration of fish. Locating a natural spawning area in the Alden River, another tributary of Winnipesaukee, and building a temporary weir across the river traps the salmon as they swim upstream, ensuring the culturists of an abundant supply of healthy fish from which to choose for breeding purposes. After enough fish are taken, the trap is removed to allow natural propagation to continue. These salmon are loaded into aerated tank trucks and brought to the central holding pen at Melbourne. During the early days, before the fishing pressure became so heavy, all the salmon necessary for propagation purposes were taken by means of salmon traps made of nets and set out in the lake along some sandbar formed by an inlet stream. This method still provides a large number of the fish needed, and the men thrill at pulling the nets each day and sorting the large thrashing salmon. Expert fingers and keen eyes pick out the best of the crop, which are loaded into live cars and hauled into shore, where they'll be placed in a truck and transported to the holding pen. It is most important to utilize all three of these methods of capturing the quota of fish needed to supply the hatcheries with the hundreds of thousands of eggs each year. For if the fall rains come late or not at all, the success of the whole program would depend upon capturing enough brood fish in the lake itself. Newspapers, radio, and television stations are given advance notice of when the stripping will take place. And the large crowds lured to the holding pens on these days is proof of the public interest created by this operation. Folks have driven here from over 200 miles away just to look at some of the large salmon that will be available in Winnipesaukee when the ice is out the next spring. These salmon are not hurt and will provide many an exciting moment on the business end of a light fly rod or trolling gear. Each female salmon must be carefully checked. Experienced fingers can tell when the eggs inside her body are floating free and ready to flow at a touch. Those not quite ripened are returned to the holding pen for another day or two. Because of the large number of fish trapped, fish culturists can be choosy, and to produce an ever better strain of fish, only the finest males or jack, like this one, and females are used. Fish culture in New Hampshire is not a hit or miss haphazard process. Experiments are made, plans laid out and followed. Every scientific tool is used to assure success of the project at the least expenditure of the sportsman's dollar. Sometimes a healthy-looking jack may be sterile, but a few minutes spent spot-checking the milt through a microscope can assure the men that the sperm from this fish is active and will do its job fertilizing the eggs. Otherwise, dead eggs will show up on the hatching trays. Fish cultural science is making giant strides to cut losses and improve the stock. Records of size and sample scales are kept from these selected fish for laboratory analysis. Thus, year by year, a faster-growing, more productive brood stock can be built up. This beautiful female salmon is really loaded and ready to be stripped of her eggs. A drip-dry pan that has been brought to the same temperature as the water in the holding pen is made ready to receive the precious living gold. Shortly after these eggs are released, they must come into direct contact with the milt to ensure fertilization. This means the milt from the jack must reach the eggs immediately because the sperms themselves will soon become inactive. This is not a time for fooling around, and culturists work together, performing in a few moments this task of parenthood, which might take weeks of great strain if the fish were left to their own devices. The average layman might assume this abnormal procedure would be injurious to the fish and that the female would die. But this is not so. Being relieved of the great burden of eggs all at once is actually much easier on her than stretching the operation over a long period of time. As one after another, the females give their eggs to be fertilized by the constant flow of milt, the hoard of living gold increases so that it may total over 200,000 eggs in a single day. Once the female has been stripped, she is gently returned to the stream undamaged, to find her way back to the lake and lead her normal life again. The next step, after the eggs have had time to harden, is the washing to get rid of the excess milk, dead eggs, and scum, which would soon begin to contaminate the good eggs. After thorough washing, they are poured into carrying jars, where enough room is left for the eggs to swell. Although the eggs are tender, they can be safely transported for the next few hours in insulated boxes. They are loaded into a pickup and rushed to the New Hampton hatchery without delay. New Hampshire has 8 rearing stations. Although most people may call all of these fish hatcheries, only 4 of them actually are used to hatch eggs. The largest of these is the station at New Hampton, where all the salmon eggs are hatched. Arriving at New Hampton, the salmon eggs are received by trained fish culturists who have made all the necessary preparations of a lying-in hospital. Jars of eggs are placed in the hatching troughs to bring the temperature of the eggs gradually to that of the hatchery water. When this is accomplished, the eggs are poured into a tub of water. The problem of getting an accurate count of more than 500,000 salmon eggs taken each year is solved by measuring their volume and is double-checked by weighing. A sample is then carefully counted, using a feather so as not to break the membrane or contaminate them. Now they know how many eggs to a liquid ounce, and can measure them in large quantities to be spread evenly on the hatching trays while keeping an accurate record of how many they have received. While these eggs develop under the constant, even flow of water at just the right temperature, the biologist is busy back in the laboratory readying the scales taken from the salmon when they spawned. Money spent for this equipment pays off, as the men learn from these studies the age and growth rate of the salmon and other fish. Just like tree rings, the scales on fish have growth rings which tell his age. By checking his size as recorded on the scale sample envelope, the biologist can tell how fast he is growing. Thus, the fish culturist will have scientific evidence of the success of his efforts to produce a faster-growing, hardier strain of salmon. Guarding against disease is a never-ending task, and back in the hatchery, the fish culturist is fighting a continual battle to keep his immense family from contracting any fungus infection that might destroy them. Like humans in a crowded tenement, eggs or fish in the hatchery are so closely confined together that they lose the protection of living widely scattered. Scientific fish culture has developed chemicals which can kill disease organisms without injuring the eggs or fish at all. In about 10 weeks after the eggs were taken, embryos inside them have developed to the point where 2 black dots can readily be seen. This is called the eyed stage. From these are the eyes of the baby salmon. By now, the eggs have passed their tenderest period and are ready for shocking. The eggs, which have been handled so gently for months, are removed from their trays and given a thorough stirring by the fresh water that is poured into the tub. This bumping around so roughly will weed out the sterile eggs as the membranes inside rupture and within a short time will turn white. Once again, the eggs will receive a treatment of disease-killing chemicals. Oxygen is used to bubble up through the solution to activate the process and keep the eggs from smothering. While the troughs are empty, they are well scrubbed to make sure the eggs will not be contaminated by any dirt or fungus. Fish culturists now know they have done everything possible to give those that remain a clean start on their next stages. The time-taking task of picking out the white eggs after shocking is tedious, but very necessary, since these would soon contaminate the good eggs It must be done every morning until no more white eggs appear. New Hampshire is a land of ice and snow in the winter, and during the long months while the eggs mature safely in their troughs, the fishmen have their work cut out for them. As the winter progresses, the snow piles higher, and it gets more difficult to keep accesses to the hatchery open and paths to the huge array of pools cleared. During extended sub-zero weather, it is a constant fight to keep the pools free of ice in order to feed, treat, and keep clean the growing fish of last year's hatch. By this time, the baby salmon are breaking free of their shells and wiggling about, enjoying their new freedom. Under natural conditions, this would not take place for another month, but warmer artesian water has given them an important head start. In producing healthier, faster-growing fish, there is no substitute for having a trained pathologist at work in the laboratory. Keeping check on New Hampshire's 8 rearing stations, each loaded with fish of various size and species, is certainly a full-time job. A station superintendent wants to know why some of his fish are not growing as fast as others, or what is causing the sudden jump in mortality, or what causes this fungus growth on his lake trout. Is there some way to grow these fish faster? Is the C9 pool overcrowded? The pathologist must find the answers to these and hundreds of other questions pertaining to fish culture. For all these, his sound scientific knowledge of fish and special techniques make him an invaluable asset to the entire fish cultural team. Returning to the hatchery, a further change has taken place. The newly hatched salmon wiggle about with a peculiar sac attached to their bellies. This is called the yolk stage, and this sac will supply them with the necessary food for the next 3 or 4 weeks while they're learning to breathe and swim. All at once, the long, cold winter breaks. The melting snow swells the brooks. The pussy willows, bursting from their buds, shout, "Spring is here!" The salmon fry are now free of their cumbersome sack and dart about in search of food. With the same loving care a mother devotes to mixing the formula for her newborn baby, the fish culturist prepares the first meal for his tiny charges. These are critical days. A mistake now could wipe out all the painstaking work done to bring these fish into the world. A special blend of liver with other essential ingredients is compounded with extreme care. Special high protein diets are fed 8 times a day. Skillful distribution of finely ground particles saves waste and ensures each tiny fish of getting all he can eat. Just eating and sleeping does not grow strong humans, and it is the same with fish. It takes exercise to build muscle, and pulling the overflow plug in the trough each day creates a current into which the fry must swim or be pressed against the screen. Healthy fish come from clean homes, and so the constant care and scrubbing of outdoor pools keep the men busy between feedings to ensure cleanliness, which helps prevent disease. Long before the baby salmon are ready to be stocked in the lakes and streams of New Hampshire waters, the Fish and Game Department is making sure they will have plenty of food to eat after they arrive by closing the waters of Black Brook to smelt dipping and building a set of cement raceways. The department has developed an outstanding program for introducing smelt into the lakes by harvesting millions of their fertilized eggs during the spawning run and transporting these to the tributaries where they will hatch. Smelt furnish the ideal forage for salmon, since they live in the same zone of the lake and grow just big enough for salmon to use. By late spring, the salmon fry have grown too large for their indoor quarters and are ready to be moved to the outdoor pools. Long-range planning calls for their transfer to another station to take advantage of water conditions, which will speed up their growth even more. Lightweight, fast trucks equipped with oxygen tanks to keep the water aerated make it possible to transport these baby fish to any one of the 8 rearing stations throughout the state. On his way, the fish culturist who drives the truck passes Winnipesaukee, the very lake where his precious cargo started life as eggs. But he knows that only a portion of them will be returned to it, since enough are hatched and reared from this source each year to stock all other salmon waters in the state, too. This load of salmon fry will make their home for the next few months at the powder mill station in New Durham. This is not a hatchery, but is known as a rearing station, with large batteries of pools where the fish can have plenty of room to grow. In order to keep an accurate record and to know how much to feed these fish to ensure fastest rate of growth, the fish are once again counted by measuring the volume in a graduate and evenly distributed in the allotted pools. Exploring their new outdoor home, the young salmon will soon discover they have plenty of room to exercise and grow, until they become large enough and old enough to fend for themselves in a big lake. The number one requirement for rearing salmon at this stage is an abundant supply of cool, clean water. The powder mill station gets all it needs and then some from 20 to 40 foot depths of spring-fed Merrymeeting Lake just above it. Feeding these growing fish is big business. To make every dollar count for as much as possible, fish food for the entire rearing system is purchased in carload lots when market prices are low and stored in the department's huge freezer lockers to be used as needed. Carefully prepared and tested formulas go into the feeding of New Hampshire's fish. Frozen meats are thawed and ground fine. Then a special brand of fish meal containing the necessary items to fortify the diet is measured out. These ingredients are thoroughly mixed together, using every drop of the juices to a consistency that is just right for the fish to eat and digest. In the face of rising prices, department fish culturists still succeed in growing more pounds of trout and salmon for less money each year through improved diets and better methods of preparation and feeding. By the time the salmon have reached yearling size, they feed ravenously. Fish culturists have learned just how much they can be made to clean up. Frequent feedings and good distribution so that each fish can get his share are the clue to preventing waste and putting on weight. The fight to prevent disease never ends. As the fish grow, whole raceways must be treated. Sometimes acetic acid is added to trace the spread of the colorless disinfectants throughout the pools. Drawing down the water level saves money and ensures more thorough killing of bacteria and parasites. The gush of fresh water as the pools fill up again dilutes the chemicals and washes them away rapidly after they have done their work. Systematic cleaning is just as important as the regular use of disinfectants. The time to prevent trouble is before it gets started. Here again, ample water is available to do the job well. Separate plumbing allows the waste to flow off from the upper pools down a side channel without cutting off the supply of fresh water to those below. Steadily increasing demands to help meet increased fishing pressure require constant expansion and modernization. Each year, part of the earnings from the sale of hunting and fishing licenses is plowed back into new construction for this purpose. This is carefully designed to tie in with the overall propagation program. Since the cost of hiring outside contractors unfamiliar with this specialized work would be prohibitive, the Fish and Game Department uses its own force account crew under the supervision of its own engineers. Rather than to increase the number of hatcheries and rearing stations, the most valuable developments have proved to be those which expanded the productive capacity of existing stations or improved natural waters by building dams and barriers. Now that hatching and rearing the landlocks is carried out scientifically, emphasis is placed on experiments and studies for stocking the salmon. smaller sizes are given a chance to escape hungry predators by stalking them in a tributary from which they can gradually work out into the lake after they have adjusted to their new environment. Bodies grown sturdy on scientific diets and months of swimming against raceway currents enable them to cope with the rigors of a fast-moving stream. In the salmon lakes, it is essential to stock bigger fish and to distribute them over a wide area. Otherwise, they could hardly be expected to run the gauntlet of hungry cannibalistic fishes of many species which already inhabit the lake. Living Gold, produced by nature, assisted by man, brings you landlocked salmon fishing in New Hampshire second to none. When you tie into one of those big battling tackle busters, don't lay it to fisherman's luck alone. Remember the year-round tireless efforts and scientific methods of the men you have been watching, who are giving everything they've got to make New Hampshire fishing the very best in the whole wide world.